face-off or Hansel and Gretel Witch Hunters? Nicolas Cage and John Travolta or Jeremy Renner and who's the actress again? Oh, hey. Crap, it's that time of year, isn't it? Well, all right. One moment. Right, now I'm a little bit more prepared because I'm too lazy to get dressed this time. But let's be honest, 2016 hasn't really been the best year for movies, hasn't it? I mean, not to say that they were all bad per se, it's just that we've had a few underwhelming duds. But that's not to say that we've dealt with some truly horrible things. And today, it's time we recollect on those. So, this is empty. There, that's better. Yeah, grab yourself a drink. This is gonna take a while. These are the top 15 worst films of 2016.
Number 15, Rules Don't Apply. I thought about this choice long and hard, thinking, does it really deserve to be on here? I mean, it's more watchable than some of the other films on this list, but on the other hand, it's also a giant disappointment, and considering some of the other films that have come out this year, that's saying a lot. Look, this film was a major passion project that Warren Beatty, one of the last living Hollywood legends, has had in development hell for over 40 years, and it's the first film in over a decade to have him in a starring role. Hell, let alone him in the director's chair.
And before I do get to any of the problems that this film is plagued with, the acting is fantastic.
Warren Beatty proves to us that he is still as magnificent an actor as he was in Bonnie and Clyde, and his portrayal of Howard Hughes was excellent. While The Aviator is technically the better film to feature Howard Hughes, his portrayal of the man himself was definitely superior to DiCaprio's. Considering that he stayed out of the spotlight for so many years, his presence in the beginning of the film adds a great deal of mystery to it. You are left in a moment of awe as you finally see him step out of the shadows, much like some of the other characters do in the film when they see him for the first time. The same can be said for the rest of the cast too. Alden Ehrenreich and Lily Collins are absolutely charming in this film, playing a forbidden couple that get together under Howard Hughes's nose. During the first half of this film, you really get invested in their story and chemistry, wanting things to go right for them in the end. That and the production value is absolutely amazing. I love films that take place during the times of old Hollywood, seeing a simpler time of how acting gigs were a little bit more challenging since you had to actually go to Hollywood to get them.
So, what's really the big problem with this film? The editing and writing are dreadful, and that's a trend you're going to be noticing throughout this list.
When you look at the trailers, it leads you to believe that it's about a forbidden love triangle between a driver, a contracted actress, and Howard Hughes. But halfway through the film, it becomes a full-on Howard Hughes biopic with some of the choppiest editing that I've seen all year, with some scenes just ending abruptly without a proper transition or indication that it's over.
It honestly felt like Warren Beatty had two different ideas for a Howard Hughes film and decided to take the best elements he liked from either one and put them together into one big mess. Although, I'm not really surprised considering this film had four different editors on there. Yeah. Four editors.
It's really upsetting because I wanted to love this movie. I wanted this to be Warren Beatty's big comeback film, but it just turned out to be one giant letdown and easily the biggest disappointment I've seen from him thus far. Hopefully we'll get to see him do at least one more film because I'd hate for this to be the last film that audiences remember him for.
If you want to see a good film about old Hollywood that came out recently, go and watch Hail Caesar, directed by the Coen brothers. It's got a much better narrative to follow, and it's still got Alden Ehrenreich in there. Sorry, Warren.
You make an old guy courageous, Marla.
Did somebody give that to you?
She hit the jackpot.
You ain't seen nothing yet.
Number 14, Trolls. When it comes to films by DreamWorks Animation, they always seem to end up in a big gamble. Either because the idea is questionable, the marketing is terrible, or maybe a mix of both.
Although not all of their films don't have those problems, like take for example Kung Fu Panda 3, which came out this year as well. However, the same can't be applied for Trolls.
I'll give the film credit, the animation is very nice looking and has a lot of color and unique textures to it. I suppose a lot of the designs were meant to emulate the design of the original toys. And the voice acting was also pretty good too, even if it did have celebrities attached to it. I was especially surprised by Zooey Deschanel's performance, as I didn't recognize her until I was looking at the credits list. She definitely shows that she's got some pretty good range for herself.
However, I just found myself overall bored with the movie.
With it being a jukebox musical, I found myself liking about one or two song numbers, but never actually found myself enjoying the characters, the story, or everything else about it. It just felt kind of boring.
I have the same feelings about Illumination Sing, but that's not on the list because I have another Illumination film on the list, and... come on, Sing had Taron Egerton singing Elton John and Seth MacFarlane singing Frank Sinatra. I can't necessarily be mad at that.
The creators of Shrek...
No troll left behind!
...invite you on a musical adventure... Yeah. That proves one voice can change the world.
Happiness is inside of all of us. Sometimes you just need someone to help you find it.
Number 13. Hello, my name is Doris.
Hey, just what everyone wanted. A mom chick flick version of American Beauty. Okay, maybe not that dark, because that would have actually been interesting, wouldn't it?
So the film is about Doris Miller, a hoarder who loses her mother and falls for the younger guy at her work. In an attempt to get his affection, she stalks him online and tampers with his relationship, all while ruining her friendship and family connections.
Oh, I'm not making that up. That actually happens in this movie. Look, don't get me wrong, I like Sally Field and all, and I'll defend her performances in the Amazing Spider-Man movies, even if she won't, but... this was a big step down, if you ask me.
At first, you'd think this was just a cute, innocent film that has some jokes that your mom would deem inappropriate, yet charming because it's Sally Field, but the film itself was just dull. I didn't find any of the jokes that funny, the story was predictable as hell, and the characters were pretty unlikable, actually.
I know it's supposed to be a twist on chick flicks with it being an older woman and all, but... I'm sorry, I hate Doris Miller as a character.
She's selfish, a stalker, treats her family and friends terribly, and unsympathetic throughout the whole film. I mean, it'd be fine if she was a character that we love to hate, but we're supposed to be rooting for her in the end.
Do yourself a favor, just go watch American Beauty. Or, if you want to watch a film with similar themes to Hello, My Name is Doris, go watch The Meddler. It's got better characters, better writing, and a protagonist you actually can find likable and funny.
I joined the LGBT knitting community. I'm not a lesbian, but I'm me there.
You know, I feel that way in Staples.
Number 12.
Well, I'm going to be pissing off a lot of people today.
Okay, look, I'll give the film this much credit. As the first official remake of the original Godzilla by Japan, I was glad to see them bring back the original message about nuclear warfare into the film, and it was also pretty refreshing to see a Godzilla film about Godzilla, unlike the 2014 Gareth Edwards film. I also enjoyed them bringing back some of the original music cues by Akira Ifukube, I hope I'm pronouncing that right, to really showcase that this is a true Godzilla film. That, and Godzilla looks fantastic. Whenever he pops up on screen, when he wasn't looking like a salamander puppet run through the wash, he was awesome!
However, my main issue with the film is that it doesn't really have a proper story or characters to get invested in. I mean, one of the main problems that I had with the Gareth Edwards 2014 movie was that everyone was more interesting than our main character played by Aaron Taylor Johnson.
With this one, I can only remember one character that actually had something interesting to her, and that was that she wanted to be president.
Even then, I didn't find much else memorable about her.
As much as I do want to enjoy this film, I just couldn't get myself invested into it. With very little characters to grow attached to and very slow direction and pacing, it just did not leave me satisfied. Number 11, The Secret Life of Pets.
I'm gonna try my best not to step on too many toes, as there are some people who do like this, but I'm sorry, I really didn't like this movie.
I mean, sure, the animation is great, the score is catchy, and some of the side characters are funny, but everything else in this film just didn't sit well. The worst crime this film commits is that it rips off the first two Toy Story movies, especially the first one with its main story. However, the difference is that while Woody and Buzz didn't get along at first, the film still establishes that a good amount of time has passed for their rivalry to develop, and they were still likable characters in their own right. They never intentionally tried to kill one another.
Whereas on the other hand, Max and Duke are unlikable characters, and they try to get rid of each other on the first day.
Even when they had sympathetic moments, or should I say ones that tried to pass themselves off as them, I didn't care about what happened to either of them. As far as I'm concerned, neither of those two deserved a happy ending for how they acted towards each other.
If you liked it, take what I say with a grain of salt and move about your day. But I will admit this, it's not the worst animated film I've seen this year. We'll be getting to that much, much soon.
A little wet, but I still look good. I look good.
Discover the secret life of pets.
Be a good boy, Leonard.
Number 10, the Divergent series, Allegiant. I'll admit, I was actually liking the Divergent series up to a point, but not after this film.
I mean, wow, was this forgettable.
This was such a forgettable mess that I actually had to go back and reread my original review of the film back in April to try and refresh myself on what happened here, and I was just left in the mood of, I saw that? The biggest what the fuck was that within the transition of three films, or 2.5 books at this point, we went from saying that Divergents were dangerous to the Fractions, to Divergents are the key to stopping Fractions, to Fractions being important to create more Divergents, just so long as they're pure Divergents like Triss and not like Four.
Everybody got that?
And you can tell everybody is phoning it in at this point.
Hell, the only one who actually seemed lively at all in this film was Miles Teller. It was kind of like he was pulling a Nicolas Cage, trying to add a sense of fun to what was essentially a dull movie to be around.
Actually, now that I think about it, Miles Teller and Nicolas Cage in a movie together would be pretty impressive. Can we get that, please?
But just because I love Miles Teller in this movie doesn't mean it's worth giving my time to anymore. I prefer it go to better films like Bleed for This or War Dogs. So, just give your money to those two instead. You'll thank me later.
Shoot her down.
Pull up!
Number 9, The Huntsman, Winter's War.
You know, for the record, I actually enjoyed Snow White and the Huntsman.
Sure, it may not be the best film, and the casting of Kristen Stewart as Snow White was very questionable, but putting that aside, I thought it was still a damn good blockbuster and was almost among my favorite films of that year.
So when I heard a sequel was coming out, I was genuinely interested. And then I immediately regretted it.
This film's narrative is just flimsy to follow as it tries to be both a prequel and a sequel to the previous film, but the way it's executed is just complete shit. even when it tries to fill in some of the gaps that we don't know happened.
It's like going from the first Hobbit movie over to the third one. It just doesn't flow right without the second one. Okay, bad example, but you know what I mean.
I will give the cast credit for trying to work with the material that they were given, but my biggest problem is with the villains. Why did they need to bring Charlize Theron back? Did we really need her to come back to remind us that this is in the same universe? Isn't Chris Hemsworth's character good enough as it is?
But with Emily Blunt as the Ice Queen? Yeah, I'm gonna say, Emily Blunt sucked in that movie.
Her character is just some loveless bitch who figures out that if she can't love, then no one will, all because her sister made her think that the love of her life killed their child so she could tap into her hidden potential.
What the hell is this? Super Saiyan logic? Oh, and don't think we're done with Emily Blunt just yet. We've still got more shit from her to cover.
Hello, Huntsman. I've missed you.
Number 8, The Shallows.
You know what I'm sick of? Zombies. Bat and sharks.
I mean, after all the stupid, god-awful movies that the Asylum and Sci-Fi Channel have been shitting out for the past decade, I've just become completely desensitized to the whole genre.
Then comes along The Shallows, a theatrical released film about a surfer who is cornered on a rock by a shark. Sounds small and simple enough, and it even stars Blake Lively.
However, the film was also directed by Kwame Collette Serra, who, while may be an excellent action director, his work in the horror genre hasn't exactly been successful. While Blake Lively is doing her best with what she's given, the film itself is just incredibly boring. The pacing is dreadfully slow, the tension never grabs me, and even the climax felt uneventful. If it weren't for this oversaturation of shark films, I might have been able to appreciate it a little bit better than what I am now.
Nah, I still would have hated it.
Number 7, The Fifth Wave. If you thought The Host was the bottom of the barrel for YA adaptations, then you are sadly wrong. The Fifth Wave is much worse and much more boring. And much like The Host, it's just nothing but a shitty ripoff of Invasion of the Body Snatchers. Just about everything in this film, aside from the performances by the young cast, is just downright awful. The effects, the characters, the writing, it feels just absolutely lifeless with every passing second. Nothing feels like it has any heart to it, and all it was done was just to make a quick paycheck for the January release crowd, and boy does that show. I feel bad for all these young actors who play the kids in this movie because I've seen them all work in much better films, so I know that they have proper potential. How is it that they were able to rope people like Chloe Moretz, Micah Monroe, Tony Revolori, and other big names like Liev Schreiber and Maria Bello to work on such tripe like this?
To all the cast members of this, I want to apologize that you had to go through with this. And please don't let there be a sequel. Please, let the YA adaptations finally stop.
Drop it!
I know you're human.
How?
Because if you were one of them, you would have shot me already.
Number 6, Zoolander 2.
You remember having that one cool uncle who you wanted to run away from home with, but you realize his life is nowhere near as interesting as you wanted it to be, and you're filled with that aura of disappointment that constantly fills your mind every second of your childhood for the rest of your life? That's how I describe Zoolander 2.
It's sad because Zoolander is such a fun film with great characters, memorable lines, and hilarious moments that showcase some of Ben Stiller's finest work as a filmmaker.
I mean, hell, I'm one of those people who loves the first film so much that he went out and bought the Blu-ray steelbook that came with a bandana. Yeah, I love the first film that much.
Just about everything in this film, from the character arcs to setups for jokes, are thrown out the window, and what we're left with is nothing but this Austin Powers wannabe with Zoolander characters thrown in. Hell, even at times when it was supposed to feel like Zoolander, it's only because it forces in jokes from the first movie as a way of telling audiences, hey, remember this from the first movie? Well, here it is again! But I guess Stiller did realize that you can't lack effort with a sequel just because we love the original so much.
A lesson that he learned the hard way after this film was a critical and financial bomb. Ben Stiller has proven in the past that he can be a solid filmmaker. I mean, look at Tropic Thunder. This is the film that helped give Robert Downey Jr. a second Oscar nomination, and that's something I gotta give Stiller much credit for doing. So, what was his excuse for shitting on this one?
He had everything in place, from the cast to its writers, so there was no excuse for this to have sucked this hard. I guess even with all the right pieces, a product can still turn out like shit.
But how am I supposed to stop Mugatu?
I'm the Mamba Pajamba! I'm the Mamba Pajamba!
You're Derek Zoolander. He stopped a Chinese throwing star with a look. Flash me that beautiful Magnum.
Wait, Magnum, now! Oh! You have this! Oh! Yeah! Tequila!
Oh! Maybe we could try a washcloth.
Number 5, The Girl on the Train.
Do you people remember Gone Girl?
You remember how intrigued you were by the marketing, and when you sat down to watch it, you were invested on where the story was going to go, and how David Fincher's directing gave off a great deal of suspense the whole way through with its twists and turns?
Because this film does, and it tries to remind you of that, only it's nowhere near as interesting.
The Girl on the Train is essentially about a jobless drunk who gets involved in a murder case after being the last person to see a woman before she went missing and realized that she was killed.
I mean, on paper it sounds interesting, but the execution is god-awful.
It constantly feels like one of those Lifetime or Hallmark Channel dramas that has hokey acting, horrid pacing, repetitive editing, and overdramatic overtones that it's hard to get invested in anything that's going on. That, and the main protagonist Emily Blunt is portraying, is just terrible. She's a jobless drunk who mooches off her friend for a place to stay and money, divorced, and tries to bring herself into affairs that were never hers to begin with.
That kind of character isn't fun to deal with in real life, nor is it fun to watch on screen. Look, just do yourself a favor, go watch Gone Girl and save yourself the trouble. Next!
Why are you here?
Because I'm afraid of myself.
Number 4, Suicide Squad. With the kind of progress that the DCEU has made so far, underwhelming is a word that I put pretty lightly. And that's saying something, considering I was one of the few people who actually liked Man of Steel. With Batman v Superman, I already knew it was gonna be okay at best, and that's what I thought it was.
Suicide Squad, on the other hand, only managed to keep pissing me off with every passing minute.
I mean, it had David Ayer attached to it, and that guy did Fury and End of Watch, which were both awesome. It even had a fantastic cast to back it up, too. Where did it all go wrong?
Oh, why not ask the studio that made this piece of shit movie?
Apparently, after seeing Deadpool bring in success and the release of Dawn of Fail, Warner Brothers decided to do more reshoots with Suicide Squad, which included messing with how the film was edited so it could be more lighthearted than its previous films. The results led to editing worse than Jonah Hex, and characters being underdeveloped like hell. Even the ones who we do get proper development for, the way that they're executed is just so redundant and sloppy that it's hard to buy into them. The worst of them all is the Joker, who had most of his scenes cut out so that way the film could be a PG-13.
Which, again, why should that be a problem? I mean, Deadpool was R-rated and that made over $700 million. I mean, yeah, so did this film for some goddamn reason, but come on, man.
It's a shame because the cast does try its best with what material that they're given, but every one of them is completely underplayed in this muddled mess with a climax that's even more lackluster than Fan Four Stick.
I mean, hell, they practically have the same third act! That and a lot of other films that came out this year.
I really wanted to like this movie, and I want to be excited for more films to come in the DCEU's future lineup. But apparently, Warner Brothers is more interested in setting up franchises and making money rather than making good movies that stand on their own. How bad is it? Suicide Squad is easily the worst DC comic book adaptation I have ever seen. Yes.
Seriously, the hell's wrong with you people?
We're bad guys. It's what we do.
Nothing really matters to me.
Number 3, Gods of Egypt. When it comes to director Alex Piraeus, all that can be said is, oh, how the mighty have fallen.
It really is a damn shame. I mean, The Crow is still one of my all-time favorite movies. However, after Gods of Egypt, I can tell there's no coming back after this. Now, if there's one thing I can agree with everybody on, it's that this film is a humongous clusterfuck.
With this film, the effects are cheap, the characters are aggravating, the dialogue is beyond horrible, and the story is so badly cobbled together, it's laughable. One minute it establishes something, only to go back on that minutes later. It felt like I was watching some bad mid-90s epic that got lost in the archives, only to be rediscovered by someone who was transferring to another studio.
However, if there's one thing I disagree with people on, it's that this film is so bad it's entertaining. I didn't see it that way.
I wanted to fall asleep so badly during this movie. Everything that I've described in this film is just so uneventful, and that's one of the worst things that a film can do. Bore you. If you plan on watching this, I'd suggest grabbing a few friends to suffer with you, so that way you at least can riff it together. Which is something I should have done to begin with.
We mortals do it all the time!
Number 2 is a 3-way tie. And I thought long and hard about giving these films their individual spots, but because of how two of them were so close to the top and all three of them are essentially in one big category, I decided, you know what, I'm compiling them all into one spot to get them out quicker. So that's pretty much why you saw Trolls and Shin Godzilla on the list. But regardless, here we go.
Number 2. Every video game movie released this year.
Except for Ratchet and Clank. That film was actually pretty good and I bought the Blu-ray for it, yeah. But regardless of what I say about this, 2016 has not been a good year for video game movies. But I still love you. And let's get into why.
Let's start off with the Angry Birds movie, a prime example of not just another bad video game movie, but a bad kids movie with three massive problems. 1. It never shuts up. No matter what scene there is always some kind of noise going on, leaving no room in the entire film for there to be a moment of silence. It's basically the equivalent of dangling keys in front of your kid so they don't get bored.
It's called learning some patience. And I was starting to lose mine while watching this pig shit. No pun intended.
Which brings me to my second problem. Everybody in this film is an asshole. Not just the villains, but the people in the village act like complete douchebags to the main character.
Oh, he has anger issues, does he? Well, of course he does, because he's dealing with some of the most insufferable a-holes ever conceived in an animated movie.
As far as I'm concerned, you people are horrible treating him like crap since he was a kid and deserve to have everything bad happen to you.
Yeah, karma's a bitch, ain't it? And problem number 3. Did anyone else realize that this film is a ripoff of Chicken Little?
Our main character, Bird, tries to warn his town or village about an impending danger, but only his friends believe him, while everybody else shuns him continuously until said danger has happened.
Yeah, because that's the right Disney movie to rip off.
Now let's move on to Warcraft. What's the story?
I don't know. All I got from this film was that orcs were invading and there's a corrupt wizard. That's it.
Everything else in this film, from the pacing to the very dialogue spoken, is so damn sloppy and half-assed that, again, I was starting to have Jonah Hex flashbacks. The only actors I actually gave a shit about were Toby Kebbell and Anna Galvin, but that's only because they were the only two actors that didn't look like they were sleepwalking. Everyone else, from Dominic Cooper to Ben Foster and to Paula Patton, were absolutely terrible in this movie.
I know you're probably going to say there's a director's cut, but that doesn't excuse it from being a shit movie.
And lastly, we have Assassin's Creed. Assassin's Creed has a lot of the same problems that I had with Warcraft, except far, far worse.
Instead of having one or two actors actually trying, this time we've got the entire cast sleepwalking through this movie. Every single one of them doesn't give a shit.
Seriously, how is it that Michael Fassbender went out of his way to produce and star in this film, yet looks so incredibly bored to be there? And not only that, but he fished out his collaborators from Macbeth, Justin Kurzel to direct, and Marion Cotillard to co-star with him, along with actors like Brendan Gleeson, Michael K. Williams, and Jeremy Irons too?
What, was Irons trying to win a bet that he could make a film worse than Batman v Superman or Dungeons & Dragons? Because, congratulations, you won the bet.
The film has a crap narrative to follow, it never invests me one bit into its mythos, the action scenes are piss poor, and the film overall is just ugly to look at.
And I think that's my biggest problem with the movie. It isn't pleasant to look at. The lighting is bad, the cinematography is awful, the editing is garbage, the makeup effects, it's just not a pleasant movie to look at, and I feel nauseated just even giving it a glance.
I really wanted to give these movies the benefit of the doubt, hoping it would finally break the video game movie curse. But sadly, all they did was end up being huge letdowns.
I just hope that Hollywood is done making these video game movies, because I just can't stand another... Oh, God damn it!
Number 1, the worst film of 2016 is The Neon Demon.
Now, you might be asking yourself, why this movie? Why not something like Nine Lives or Shut-In or Collateral Beauty? Well, I didn't see those films. I saw this, though. I saw it in theaters. And I walked out.
Before we get into this, let me talk a little bit about the director of this, Nicholas Winding Refn, the man behind such films as Drive and Only God Forgives.
They're the only films that I've seen before this year, and Drive was the only one that I actually liked.
I will admit that he has captured a unique look and style to his films, regardless of how the film itself may turn out. So, going into this, I was pretty half and half with this director, expecting a stylish parody on the world of fashion models, at least that's what the trailers made it look like to be. Not only that, but it was also one of the many films coming out this year that was being released under Amazon Studios. Of course, being an Amazon Prime user, I could have easily checked out the film online, but I decided to see it in theaters because I prefer that as my movie-going experience.
I should have just stayed home.
In much of the same vein as Only God Forgives, The Neon Demon is nothing but style over substance pretentious bullshit. The basic premise is that it's about a young girl who enters the fashion world, and her rivals are all jealous that she's getting more attention.
I mean, I get what he's trying to do, trying to say that the world of fashion modeling is nothing but a dog-eat-dog world. But, I'm sorry, there's a better way to have this represented. You could have story, characters, conflict, symbolism that makes sense, or better yet, a cast that actually emotes.
That's been one of the biggest problems that I've had with this film, is that there isn't a story other than the one sentence synopsis that I gave you, and there is practically no one to find anything of interest or value with, nor do any of the cast members try to... Actually, none of them even look like they're even bothering to try. Everybody is so wooden, from Elle Fanning to Jenna Malone to even big-name stars like Christina Hendricks and Keanu Reeves.
Come on, I've seen porn stars with better acting than this.
All the interesting things that actually do happen, happen so out of nowhere and misplaced that it felt like the director was going to pop up on screen and look at the audience and say, "Go on, ask me what this means. I'm symbolic." Seriously, why did a mountain lion pop up in this film? Why did this girl not call the cops when she heard her neighbor being raped? What's the point of the upside down Triforce that pops up in the film constantly?
But what made me draw the line for this movie was in the third act. Or what I assumed was the third act, because this film has such awful structure that it doesn't even know where its story is.
By the time that Elle Fanning is staying over at Jenna Malone's house, we get a scene of Jenna Malone attending to her job at a morgue and proceed to commence necrophilia.
It was pretty much at that point that I just walked out on this movie and threw up. I was already fed up with this movie being so uninteresting, so falsely symbolic, and so far up its own ass that for them to throw shock value like that just for the sake of shock value was insulting.
Months later, I decided to look up the ending and found out that it only got even worse just from reading the text on Wikipedia alone. Want to know the ending? Look it up yourself. If you are somebody who liked The Neon Demon, good for you, but if you're going to be one of those people trying to persuade me that I'm wrong or that I just don't get it, fuck off. I hated this movie, I'm never going to like it, The Neon Demon is easily the worst film I've seen this year, and I hope to never give it any more attention than I've already given it now. Thank you, good night.
Are we having a party or something? My mother used to call me.